The following is a News on 6 special presentation. Silver wings in prairie skies. Here's your host, Scott Thompson.
Hard to believe, looking around this place now, to realize that it played such a pivotal role in the outcome of the Second World War, right here in Miami, Oklahoma. I'm standing inside what was the administration office of the number 3 British Flying Training School. The only building still remaining is the old barracks. They store blue jeans there now. There was a school just like it in Ponca City, Oklahoma. It's a story unknown to most, but photographer Grant Gerondale and I traveled across Oklahoma and across Great Britain so the story wouldn't be forgotten of the boys who grew into men here, who earned silver wings in prairie skies.
In stolzer Ergebenheit, diesem Deutschland, den Tod.
Life was so unreal at times. You know, you never knew what was coming next.
It was quite an era in my life.
Hear these aircraft going over to bomb Coventry and these other places.
There was a time, not so long ago, when madmen had their way, and terror lurked in every shadow, in every place.
If anyone says they weren't frightened, I would look them very firmly in the eye.
Laugh and sing, be happy, it's the thing. Be happy, wink your eye, then fix your tie, be as I, be happy.
It all seemed so far away from Miami, Oklahoma. It was Europe's war that springtime of 1940. Someone else's pain played itself out on the newsreels at the Coleman Theater. But that would change soon enough. Fate would cast itself on Main Street and forever change two nations, two peoples, and two Oklahoma towns.
Of course, you see, the war changed a lot of people's lives, didn't it?
Great Britain stood alone. Hitler's evil had rolled across the continent, leaving devastation and despair in its wake. But in the late summer heat of 1940, hope was resuscitated, given a second breath by a handful of young British pilots. Hitler had counted on his Luftwaffe to deal a knockout blow at Britain's heart. After 11 months of fiery rage, England stood fast, and the Royal Air Force became legend.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
But the RAF needed more pilots and some place to train them. Every airstrip in Great Britain was given to the war effort. There was no room for beginners, no place for practice. And though the United States was not yet at war and therefore neutral, negotiations had been going on at the highest levels in London and Washington. In May 1941, Franklin Roosevelt and Winston Churchill finally signed off on a secret plan that would bring British cadets to the United States.
We were sworn to great secrecy. We weren't allowed to tell anybody this at all.
The course of the Second World War was about to change in Oklahoma. There were 6 British flying training schools, 2 of them in Oklahoma. The operation in Ponca City was run by the G.A.R School of Aeronautics, Miami's by the Spartan School of Aeronautics of Tulsa, all of it paid for by the British government. Miami's school opened first. By June 1941, construction crews were at work building an air base from scratch. At the same time, the first cadets arrived in Tulsa to begin training at what was then Municipal Airport.
There was still very much of a pioneering sort of feeling about the place. There were still a lot of people in cowboy boots and 10-gallon hats and things of that sort.
David Green was in that first class. After 1 month in Tulsa, he and the others boarded a school bus bound for Miami. A military base had gone up overnight, and an amazing adventure was about to begin.
We were meeting people who had never seen the ocean before, leave alone met an Englishman.
We traveled to Great Britain to meet the men and hear the stories of valor and honor and fear. They're scattered through the smallest of villages and the biggest of cities, but a piece of each of their hearts is always in Oklahoma.
They were the legendary pilots of the Second World War. The planes they flew made history. They broke Hitler's back, and they learned to do it in Oklahoma.
You knew there was a certain amount of pressure on. You weren't out there on a holiday.
The training took about 6 months. It was done in American planes, sporting American markings, taught by American instructors. George Mayer was one of them. He was 26 when he signed on in Miami.
They sent the cream of the crop over here, and they didn't want us to send them back, not as polished pilots. They wanted professional pilots.
Lillian Taylor failed the secretarial typing test at the Conoco refinery, so she was hired as an instructor in Ponca City because she had 4 hours of flight training under her belt, and she was a veteran.
The people that we had, most of them had never even driven a car before, let alone an airplane.
Yet they were the boys of whom so much was expected. Freedom's very being rested on the scrawny shoulders of British teenagers. Derek Maddox was 18.
We really didn't have a teenage. We missed it. We went from being schoolboys to men quite quickly.
But it was like going back to school, which we had just recently left.
We are all aware that it was the most significant thing that happened to us in our young lives.
They came of age at a wrenching time and found themselves above the clouds of a strange land, learning a deadly skill, asked to preserve a way of life and the ideals of free men.
I mean, I consider myself an ordinary man, but for those 6 years, it was something extraordinary.
Extraordinary men aren't born. They are ordinary men who rise to the occasion, who touch the place in the spirit where all human experience intersects. Courage and honor would, in time, carry the day, borne on silver wings, proudly earned in prairie skies.
When Silver Wings in Prairie Skies continues, the British cadets recount their arrival in Oklahoma and their comrades lost to war. The cadets came back to Oklahoma during the week of VE Day, and the memories came flooding back with them of hard-fought challenges and monumental success, of places like the old hangar across the way there and the tarmac where they lifted off to earn silver wings in prairie skies.
It didn't look like a place of secrets, as if it should have any bearing on the war raging in Europe. Miami, Oklahoma, 1941, went about its business and expected the rest of the world to do the same. But there were murmurs about what was going on at the edge of town, of the air base that went up almost overnight, and the young men pouring in with the strange accents and identical gray suits.
The idea that we were sneaking into the United States in civilian clothes was totally bizarre, because we must have stuck out like a sore thumb.
Though the people of Miami could only speculate on the strange goings-on, the President of the United States knew the facts. So did the Prime Minister of Great Britain. The two were kept abreast of every move being made in Miami because Oklahoma had entered the Second World War.
As I recall, I was eager to go into the Royal Air Force.
But it would be a circuitous route for Derek Maddox and the others. Jammed in the holds of military and civilian ships, they would first have to endure an Atlantic crossing, steering around Nazi submarine packs before reaching New Brunswick, Canada. There, each bewildered British lad was given a list of towns and asked to make a choice.
And we looked at the list, and one of them was Miami. And I thought, well, this must be for me, you see. So I dived for that one. And then suddenly somebody said, it's not Miami, Florida. It's Miami, Oklahoma.
Shoved on a southbound express, it soon became clear they weren't bound for the ocean side. After 3 days of travel, the train pulled into the other, Miami.
crossroads with traffic lights, and there was a drugstore and the Coleman Theatre.
And we were amazed at the casualness of everything. Life was going on so sweetly.
Well, the expression culture shock had yet to be invented, but that's exactly what it was.
Wide-eyed innocence plunked down in the middle of the prairie. No one could have guessed it then, but an enduring relationship had begun.
In December.
They were teenagers, mostly. They came from all across Great Britain, from the row houses of London and Liverpool, seaside fishing towns, Welsh coal fields, and the tiny villages tucked into the Scottish Highlands. They had no idea what to expect, no thought as to what awaited them in the United States. They did know one thing for sure, that their country was the last in Europe where freedom's banner still flew. To keep it flying would require the fight of their lives. But first, they had to learn to fight. So their days were spent learning to fly. 2 years of lessons shoehorned into 6 months. 300 teenagers at any one time experiencing the exhilaration of flight for the first time.
On a bright, sunny morning, you know, with blue sky, and there you are, you get into your PT-19 or your Harvard or whatever it is, off you go. And you're up there and you can do what you like, really. And that was really quite exciting, I think, for everyone.
In a world turned upside down, Miami became a place where young men seemed invincible, where everything seemed possible. Raymond Baxter was 19 when he landed his first plane, 5 days after arriving in Oklahoma.
And the instructor would get out. I mean, just like the engine's still running, and say, well, there you go, son, on your way.
When the cadets weren't flying, they were studying strange new things like astronomy and navigation. Or they marched. The sky was their calling. They never promised to keep perfect cadence. But slowly, and perhaps amazingly, it was all coming together. The transformation from schoolboy to soldier was working. And then the final piece of the puzzle fell into place with a jarring thud.
I ask that the Congress declare a state of war.
Lillian Taylor was an instructor at the Ponca City School on December 8, 1941, when FDR's words were piped into the base cafeteria to British cadets finishing a meal.
They stood up and gave us kind of a standing ovation that we were into it now, and there was some hope that they could survive.
And for the first time, the secret British flying training schools were secret no more. The gray suits were tossed, and uniforms could be worn on Main Street. And American boys arrived to learn to master the sky. Because in the name of all things good and decent, it was a struggle that had to be won.
Well, it was, of course, an unforgettable experience.
No day more unforgettable than that which brought wings. The people of Miami would come to the tarmac and watch as proud parents might. Their boys had made their way in the world. Ken O'Dell was 20 that day.
A lot of people were there, a lot of civilians came. We had invitations and we sent them out and we were amazed at the support that we got from the local people.
The hope of two nations, side by side, each given the wings of their own grateful people and that of the other. Proud moments that live in the soul forever.
It was an achievement to learn to fly, to get their wings, which was quite a mountain in one's lifespan.
Derek Maddox was 18 when he scaled his mountain in Oklahoma. The next day, he and the others were back on a train headed for home to be given a Spitfire or Hurricane or Lancaster bomber and an appointment with history.
It was a satisfying feeling to know that you'd done the best you could with them and you had some pretty good pilots developed. You knew that they were going into combat, and there were just a lot of things you'd think about.
Like who would live and who would die.
I'll be all the familiar places.
More than half the graduates from those early courses would be dead within the year. But they kept coming to Miami and to Ponca City, and they kept lining up to have silver wings pinned on their chests. They took the skills they learned in Oklahoma and crushed a tyrant. In the name of all things good and decent, they could do no less.
I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing.
Coming next, the British cadets, now grown gray, return to Miami for what many believe will be their final visit. Silver Wings in Prairie Skies continues. For the British cadets who came to Miami to earn their Royal Air Force wings, this is about the spot where their life's great adventure began, where the train dumped them off. 50 years later, they came back to celebrate VE Day in a little better style this time, but each of them knowing in the backs of their minds that this would perhaps be their final visit to Oklahoma. The first time they saw Oklahoma, it was from the window of a train car. Homesick, scared, and thousands of miles from family, they had come to learn to fly, only to know that when they had, they would face the fury of Hitler's Luftwaffe and the judgment of history. Most of the men of No. 3 British Flying Training School are in their 70s now. The dashing boys from Britain have become graying old men. So this trip back to their youth has special meaning. You see, most believe it will be their final visit to Miami.
We've got to recognize that we shan't be here to go again, which is a big regret, but it's something that you've got to face.
They do say you should never go back in life. I'm not sure that I agree with that.
Especially not when the path leads to Middle America and the kind memories of Oklahoma.
So coming back to the USA isn't really like going abroad in some ways. So it's almost like coming home to us, I think.
More than 70 of them came home to celebrate the week of VE Day in the place where their life's greatest adventure began. And even a steady rain and blustery wind couldn't dampen their spirits, though it did keep them out of the skies this time around.
Oh, it's a lovely day. It really is. And there are chaps here that I haven't seen for 50 years, you know. I met my instructor yesterday. I didn't recognize him. He recognized me for some unknown reason. But oh, what a, you know, what a joy.
To still be able to share the stories and pick the faces out of scrapbooks and bask in the glow of a good life and good friends, what a joy indeed.
I shall remember this place to the end. I really will.
It becomes a whirlwind of emotion and expectation. They flew from an airfield at the edge of nowhere. Now it's become immersed in the ugly jumble of neon and chaos that marks most American towns. Things change.
Not for the good, I'm afraid, in lots of places, you know. When we came up the main road, it was just fields all the way to the field.
Can this really be the place of a spit-and-polished military base where so many men fulfilled so much? The only traces now are crumbling foundations and peeling paint. It's a place that once stood at the forefront of the battle between evil and good, but it serves no purpose now, except in the hearts of the boys who grew to be men here. And in a dingy barracks where boxes of blue jeans stacked to the ceiling, Ron Sloan struggles to find the place where he slept for 6 months.
Oh, no, this is not as good as it was. And I'll tell you what, the officers wouldn't like to see the state of the floor compared with our day and anything like that, and you were in dead trouble. I must say that I much preferred it in 1942 than it is today.
The Coleman Theater is slowly being restored to the grandeur the cadets knew when they were in town, when they would bring a date and sit in the back row, and the war would seem so far away. And on this final trip back, the cadets offer a token of their appreciation for the kindness given by a movie palace.
And in many cases here in Miami, of course, it was also served as the catalyst for quite a few youthful romances. I think that's probably enough said about that.
And at Miami High School, perhaps the cadets' most heartfelt gesture.
And we are, in the nature of things, a last man out operation. That means last man out, switch off the light.
When the last man dies, so too does their organization. But they've seen to it that their time in Miami will always live on. They've contributed more than $11,000 in scholarship money to be used by Miami High School students at the town's NEO A&M College.
the dollars that this particular gift will generate will provide scholarships for graduates of Miami High School long after all of us are already gone. So that's a good feeling for me as president of our institution. And again, let me tell you how much we appreciate it. We'll remember you forever and ever. Thank you very much.
Who'd have guessed it, that the boys who poured into town so long ago would come back, would remember this place with such affection, that Oklahomans would never forget their British boys?
We became good friends. Yes. Very good friends.
There will always be a place in Miami for the Union Jack, because wherever there is a human heart, there is a place for friendship. Coming next, the remarkable story of Miami's Mrs. Hill. She tended to the British cadets who fell from the sky. Silver Wings and Prairie Skies continues. It was a display of warm-hearted devotion to an extraordinary degree when British air cadets were training here in Miami, Oklahoma during the Second World War. It's a tale that stretches from Ottawa County to Great Britain. The story of Mrs. Frantie Hill, who tended to the boys who never had a chance to earn silver wings in Prairie Skies. Jack Taylor arrived in Miami, Oklahoma in September 1941 to earn his Royal Air Force wings. Like every other class of British cadets arriving in Oklahoma, his was given a welcoming dance at the country club. That's where he met Rosnell Hill. She was just beginning her freshman year at Miami's NEO Junior College.
And I was about the right age to enjoy a good-looking fellow.
When Jack wasn't flying, he and Rosnell could be regular teenagers. Picnics and movies and bike rides. And Rosnell's mother, Frantie Hill, took a special liking to the outgoing, kindly young man.
I was an only child. She never had any boys, and she just kind of took him under her wing.
Until he could earn a pair of his own. After 6 months in Miami, Jack Taylor was back on a train, heading for home and the fighter plane given him by the Royal Air Force. In Miami, the British cadets kept coming, and inevitably, so too, did death. Everyone knew it had to happen. Fred Tuft was the first. He walked into his moving propeller the night before he was to leave Oklahoma. Mrs. Hill pasted the notice in her scrapbook, and those of the others who fell from the sky. And one day, she and her daughter, Rosnell, walked to the G.A.R. cemetery on the edge of town to visit the graves.
And they were lumpy, and nothing had been planted or anything else. Well, I'm going to do something for Jack's countrymen, she said. So she did.
From her own garden, Mrs. Hill brought iris and roses, pansies and juniper trees. She weeded and watered and fronted each stone with the Union Jack. And each time a new stone was added to the long row, she'd do the same.
They were born to the verdant green valleys of Mother England. Fate would demand they be buried beneath the windswept plains of Oklahoma. But they wouldn't be alone, and they wouldn't be forgotten. Miami's Mrs. Hill would see to that.
She would write each family so they would know their sons weren't forgotten in a faraway land. And grieving, grateful mothers would write back, the bottom of their hearts tucked away in Mrs. Hill's scrapbook.
My dear Mrs. Hill, your kindness in what you are doing causes me to shed tears. Tending my dear son's grave is very much appreciated. This is the time I miss him. He kept our garden a picture. Could you see to it he has flowers for his birthday?
And a special day would be marked with the bounty of Mrs. Hill's backyard, and a faraway heart would be at peace. Jack Taylor kept in touch with the Hills. He named his Spitfire for his Miami sweetheart, and it carried him safely through the rage of North Africa and Malta and France, until Nazi guns brought him down 2 months before the war's end. Jack Taylor was listed as missing in action. It would be months before word reached Miami that he had been marched into the forest and shot dead.
It had been so long by then that I was just sure anyhow. Mother was really upset.
Jack Taylor always promised he'd come back to Miami after the war. When the fighting stopped, Mrs. Hill didn't.
She kept walking the mile to the cemetery, loaded down with slips and cuttings from her garden, to give to the boys so far from home. It was her way of making sense of a world that seemed without its senses, because no one should ever be forgotten.
Personally, I can see how somebody would start doing this in the heat of the war, knowing that the few RAF graves appearing there, she'd go along and do a bit of hoeing and so on and so forth. But you can just imagine the resolve that that lady had and the love and devotion to the work to keep it up when, you know, the war began to fade into everybody's memory.
Mrs. Hill never allowed it to fade from a line that grew to number 15. And from a grateful nation it came for service in the cause of freedom, with deepest gratitude from His Majesty King George VI, because they were so far from home, but they were never forgotten.
I'm sure she was surprised, but I doubt if Mother was aware how much an honor it really was.
Franti Hill placed the King's medal on the shelf and walked to the cemetery to weed and water and say hello to her boys. It was a pilgrimage she continued for 22 years.
Died June the 26th, 1944.
More than half a century after they left Miami, the British boys came back to mark VE Day. Their gait slowed, their hair gone silver. They form a long line to front their friends who lie young forever, who shall always be ageless, always side by side, in a long row of marble that grew to number 15, and at the end, a 16th, Mrs. Hill and her husband Claude. In life, she didn't want her boys to be alone, to be forgotten. And so it is to be through the ages.
Rosnell continues her mother's work. She travels from Tulsa to Miami every Memorial Day to place wreaths on the cadets' graves, and the Miami Garden Club provides flowers at other times of the year. Coming up next on Silver Wings and Prairie Skies, travel along on a remarkable pilgrimage as a son comes from Great Britain to Miami to meet the father he never knew. There is in each of us a need to know where we came from, to find the thread that links us to the generations. John Raisbeck's thread links him here to Miami, Oklahoma, and the young British cadets who earned their wings during the Second World War. His is a remarkable pilgrimage that stretches from Great Britain to Ottawa County, and the ties which forever bind him to the men who earned silver wings in Prairie Skies.
Ken Raisbeck was still a newlywed when the darkness of war clouded his life. A 26-year-old London policeman, he left his wife behind in the spring of 1944 and traveled to Miami. His goal was to learn to fly. Oklahoma would give him that chance.
Ken Raisbeck wanted nothing more than to earn his RAF wings in Oklahoma, come home to Britain, and do his part against the Nazi scourge. 4 days after Ken Raisbeck left for the United States, his son was born. The two would never meet.
Because on the morning of June 26, 1944, just weeks away from earning his wings, Ken Raisbeck lifted off into the vast prairie sky and never came back. Ken O'Dell was Ken Raisbeck's squadron leader and friend.
We didn't hear until the evening, but we were all rather quiet, as I remember. You know, we didn't talk a lot about it because we were wondering what had happened. We didn't really know what had happened.
No one ever would know how the crash happened, and on a sweltering summer morning, Ken Raisbeck was lowered beneath the Oklahoma prairie. All he ever wanted was a pair of wings. John Raisbeck's memories of his father are black and white ones, tucked inside a memory book he carries. We sat down together at the Royal Air Force Museum in Hendon, England, in front of the same kind of plane in which Ken Raisbeck was killed, and listened to a son speak of a father he never knew.
This is the one that I like best of all because he's right in the middle of the photograph. There is a photograph here of my father with his flight instructor standing
by the and the telegram that brought news of his father's death. John Raisbeck was 4 months old when his mother received it. 50 years later, he is about to travel to Oklahoma with the returning cadets, and for the first time, come face to face with the missing part of his being.
and I feel it's my duty and I should be there with the other guys.
That's right, Ken. And we're pals together.
To be in Miami, Oklahoma gives John Raisbeck a sense of peace. To be in the last place his father knew. And he's brought his 20-year-old son Oliver so the next generation of Raisbecks won't have to wonder. And during this reunion weekend, John uses every spare moment in a search for someone or something that can trigger a story of his father. Did you know him? Did he tell you a story? Are you in the photo with him? Was he your friend? In the quiet of a Sunday morning, John Raisbeck's pilgrimage has come full circle. Half a century passes away in the footsteps on a puddle-filled cemetery lane. And for the first time, a son meets his father. It is one of the defining moments of a lifetime.
It reminded me of a poem that was written by one of our great poets, Rupert Brooke, who said, and I'll have to think very carefully about this, if I should die, think only this of me, that there is some corner in a foreign field that is forever England.
And after waiting this long and coming this far, John Raisbeck finds it hard to leave.
Out comes the coffin from the hearse here, and it's moved here.
With the pictures in his memory book, he tries to imagine the day his father was buried, the heat of the morning, and the pain it caused his family so far away. And John Raisbeck is enveloped in peace and calm.
But it's a pilgrimage that I've had on my mind for a long time. He hasn't been forgotten, never. But I felt that I needed to do something special, and I've done it.
Kenneth Raisbeck died June the 26th, 1944.
And the next day, VE Day, John Raisbeck stands in the long line of cadets grown gray alongside Stan Barry, who carried Ken Raisbeck to his grave. And on a simple spray of flowers, a son has written to his father.
It says, I proudly stand here on this 50th anniversary of VE Day. Although we never met, I know you well, and you're always with me. From John.
Think only this of me, that there is some corner in a foreign field that is forever England. And in this corner of a prairie cemetery, there is now a part of John Raisbeck and the invisible bond that forever ties a son to his father.
Their lives were shaped by the experiences they shared here in Oklahoma. Coming next, the cadets recall the wondrous months they spent here in Miami and in Ponca City, and the pull which brings them back. Silver Wings in Prairie Skies continues. The cadets didn't spend much time in Oklahoma, just about 6 months for each man. But their love for this state and its people has reached across oceans and across decades. Because there are only a few defining moments in each lifetime. And one of the biggest for them came here in Oklahoma, earning Silver Wings in Prairie Skies.
What is it that brings them back to a place they left so long ago? It was just a heartbeat in their lifetimes when they came to Oklahoma to earn their wings, when they were boys and the world had gone mad.
You never lose it. You know, I can remember Miami with fond affection and have the urge to go back there repeatedly. And it's just one of those major milestones in your life.
They poured into Miami and Ponca City for 4 years. First, the British, soon joined by Americans. Between 1941 and 1945, close to 4,000 young men climbed an airplane for the first time and learned to fly in Oklahoma. And they learned about life.
Your eyes have been opened. Travel broadens the mind, and I think it broadens it terribly in the case of young people.
They were lucky enough to land in two big-hearted Oklahoma towns, where they started out as curiosities and ended up as sons.
We had heard about the legend of American hospitality, but when we experienced it, it was so total, I'm tempted to say as to be embarrassing, but it wasn't, because it was so kindly met.
In Miami, it began every time a new train full of cadets pulled into town. Sometimes a band would be playing. Sometimes there'd be speeches. There was always someone there to say hello.
And when we arrived, we found invitations to the country club to meet the young ladies of the town and their chaperones, who of course were their parents, who were going to keep a very close watch on us.
Dance to Swingaroo Quickie, jukebox Saturday night.
Each new class was welcomed with a dance. The young ladies couldn't believe their luck. Ruth Googe was a 16-year-old student at Afton High School.
They were so different. They spoke differently, you know, and they were very outgoing young fellows, you know, just full of vim and vigor. And they just swarmed the town, seemed like.
And so we leave them in fond embrace, the boy in khaki, the girl in lace.
David Green was a dashing 18-year-old when he landed in Miami and landed a local girl.
I said, well, look, what are we going to do tomorrow night and the night after that and so on? And she said, oh, I can't do this frequently, she said, because I'm going steady. And I said, what do you mean you're going steady? She said, well, I've got a steady boyfriend. And I said, well, I'll write him a little note and see if I can borrow you for 3 months, you see. And he did. It was the craziest thing.
Even the boyfriends were friendly.
Yes, absolutely. Lent me his car.
Perhaps to drive to the drugstore for milkshakes or the city pool for a dip. Each cadet was adopted by a local family. Weekends were free and the young flyers were welcomed into homes as far away as Joplin, Missouri and Pittsburgh, Kansas. It was a time to relax and leave the war behind.
You only had to walk outside the camp and somebody would stop a car and say, where would you like to go? And we could go off to Joplin or even Kansas City even.
We ranged forth abroad.
Hitchhiking their way around a wondrous new place. From Michigan Avenue to Pikes Peak, it was a heady time to be alive. For boys who had lived through 2 years of food rationing and power blackouts, America proved amazing.
The lights were all on, the food in all the shops. We were having ice creams until it came out of our ears.
If the cadets were curious about their new surroundings, Miamians certainly felt the same about their new neighbors.
In this country at that time, people would say, well, actually, and if ever we said, actually, someone would say, hey, listen, come over here, listen to this chap say, actually. And it became a little embarrassing, but it was good fun.
You see, people in Miami had never seen the sea. It seemed extraordinary.
Mary Roxborough was the wife of Alan Roxborough, who for 2 years was the RAF commander at Miami. She moved to Oklahoma with a young daughter and tried to lead a normal life.
Well, I just went and bought an American women's cookbook and just carried on as at home, but much the same. And I've still got that cookbook and I still look at it.
And then when the war was over,
Jack Barrington thought so much of Ponca City, he returned there after the war and married a local woman. And though the paint is peeling and the wood rotting on the old barracks, the ghosts of this place are good and kind ones.
What did you take from here that stays with you to this day, if anything?
Oh, I suppose the only word that comes to mind is friendship, which is what it's all based on, I think.
Dar School has so many wonderful memories.
And after the war, Harold Cogman turned down job offers from across the world to return to Ponca City without one. He had been captured by kindness.
We couldn't walk down Grand Avenue without being stopped and asked for supper or lunch or can we take you anywhere?
And in the attics and basements of those who were touched, you'll find memories carefully wrapped. After this picture was taken, Alma Dixon invited the cadets to lunch in her home, and each signed her guest book.
There is no greater compliment that I could possibly pay than by saying that when I'm in your home, I'm reminded of my own home, Jeff.
To Oklahoma, the young Brits brought spirit, spunk, and soccer games. In return, they took away confidence and courage.
The cadets spent just 6 months in Oklahoma, in a lifetime, just the blink of an eye. But for many, it became the most profound experience of their lives. Miami and Ponca City shaped them into the men they became.
And to this day, wherever in Great Britain you find them, you will find there too a love of Oklahoma and Oklahomans. That's what brings them back. That's why they've never really left.
In my book, there's only one sort of special relationship, and that's the friendship of the ordinary people with the ordinary people. And that's what brings us back after 50 years, to come back to see them again, because they're our friends. That's a special relationship to me.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow. Just you wait and see. There'll be love and laughter and peace ever after tomorrow when the world is free.
They were part of a remarkable generation and a remarkable time. They lifted off from Ponca City in Miami, Oklahoma, and landed in our history books and earned the eternal gratitude of the ages. For the News on 6, I'm Scott Thompson. Thanks for watching Silver Wings in Prairie Skies.
I'll be seeing you.